Welcome to another New Jersey Constitutional Republicans Virtual Conversation. We have Amity Schlaes with us today, who is a conservative American author, writer, and columnist. She writes about politics and economics from a classically liberal perspective. So what that means, Amity, is pre-FDR New Deal liberal. She has authored 5 books, including 3 New York Times bestsellers. One of them we're going to discuss today, Coolidge. And she currently chairs the Board of Trustees of the Calvin Coolidge Presidential Foundation. She is a recipient of the Bastiat Prize and, more recently, the Distinguished Bradley Prize. Many readers know Ms. Schlaes from the Wall Street Journal, where she served on the editorial board, writing on foreign policy, taxation, and other topics. Or from the Financial Times and Bloomberg, each of which carried her syndicated column over the years. Currently, Ms. Schlaes appears in print, Forbes, and in National Review. She's a graduate from Yale University with a bachelor's degree in English, magna cum laude, and she attended the Free University of Berlin. Amity Schlaes, it's an honor to have you here with us today.
Glad to be here. Glad to be here.
And I want to begin this program by congratulating you on the event that just occurred 3 weeks or so ago in Washington, D.C. at the Library of Congress. The Coolidge and the American Project Conference was just an extraordinary event. I'm going to be sharing pictures with the audience, but congratulations on running a wonderful event. And I know you prepared diligently for it.
Thank you. And the Coolidge Foundation did it, and it was a splendid event because we had a marvelous partner in the Library of Congress.
Yes, it was remarkable. It was the panelists, the panels, it was so informative. All of the young students there interested in Calvin Coolidge, it gives us a lot to anticipate in being very thankful and happy that these younger people are interested in Calvin Coolidge. And of course, Amity, this is the 100th anniversary this year of Calvin Coolidge being sworn in as president at the death of William Harding. And then it's also the 10th anniversary of your great book. And here it is, Coolidge. What a wonderful book, great history. And we want to talk a little bit about that today, about some of the highlights of the book. In the beginning of the book, Amity, you talk about the fact that there are a lot of alleged failures attributed to Coolidge, but that's not the essence of his story. And why is that?
I don't know why Coolidge has such a bad reputation. If he were a stock, he'd be a buy. He kind of gets skipped over in school. He's treated as a seat warmer between more dramatic figures, maybe the Roosevelts, an in-between character, a footnote, which really isn't justified. One of the things on all our minds today, and certainly was discussed at this conference, is debt and budgeting. And Coolidge actually ran surpluses in his 67 months in office. He actually cut the budget. He didn't just reduce its growth, which is what they call cutting nowadays. Many Republicans refer to cutting when they mean reducing growth. Coolidge actually cut the budget so that the number was lower when he left office in 1929 than when he came in 23. It's remarkable. And he did it all through concerted effort, through a strong platform. And we can talk about that through decency and often through bipartisan work.
And let's go back to the beginning, Amity, with a young Calvin Coolidge attending the Black River Academy in Ludlow, Vermont. And he became fascinated with Cicero, of all people, who was a great orator, great promoter of rhetoric in the true sense of the word. And even though he's been known as Silent Cal, he got distinguished. He became very distinguished because of his oratory skills. Is that correct?
That's right. Coolidge was a shy boy, but no politician is shy. Those are two circles that do not overlap. So let's say Coolidge had a habit of refraining from speech until he found a way to speak, and that was through high school and college debate. And at the Coolidge Foundation, we actually have high school debate programs because speaking parentally or to parents Kids who don't always do well in the classroom sometimes do well in debate. It's surprising. And all kids learn something from stepping into a role and making a formal argument. I'm not talking about saying this politician is stupid or that politician. I'm talking about unveiling three or four reasons why a policy is good or bad. And you should see kids flower. That's what happened to Calvin. He didn't make it into any fraternity in college. Finally made it into one, gave a speech, had the suit and everything. And he said to his father, "Nothing makes me feel as good as to know I've given a good speech." And that's what you want to see in any young person, that they find an area where they can do pretty well and where they didn't expect to. And that was the making of Calvin.
One of the important influences throughout the book, Amity, is a man by the name of Charles Garman. And why was he so important to Calvin Coolidge?
Well, I'm going to stop here and say, I don't know, because he's got a guru, like there's a small cottage industry about Garman. What I can discern about Garman, who was his teacher at Amherst, where he attended college, Coolidge's teacher. One, Coolidge's education up to about junior year of college had been almost exclusively rhetoric and lecture. There wasn't much opportunity for what we would call seminar or Montessori or anything with interaction really between student and teacher. Garman taught seminar. And so when a child moves into that, he's like, wow, I really like this teacher. This teacher actually asked me questions. And in the Coolidge film, Steve Forbes speaks to that. It's now on Fox Nation. If you want to go look, you can learn all about Coolidge's boyhood. Anyway, Garman also had a very useful point he made to Coolidge, which is the concern young people have of after college, what am I going to do? And it's a sort of this idea that come senior year, oh, I have to pick precisely what the right trade is for me. Otherwise, I'll fail. But Garman said, life isn't like that. Life is like a river. You kind of get in, kind of try and stay in the middle and float along with the current, and you'll gravitate towards the things you're better at, but mainly just stay in, play well, don't get swept away by bad habits or irrelevant currents, and you'll get somewhere if you work hard. This was enormormously comforting to Calvin. And Coolidge talks about this later. I don't want to psychologize him too much because he was a man of strength. But that moment when you're just jumping off into the river from senior year to life, we all know what that's like. And Garman said that. I think a philosopher who is under discussed vis-a-vis Coolidge, and is certainly very important, is beyond Cicero, who not only spoke well, but chronicled the descent from republic to democracy to autocracy in Rome. Mm-hmm. So Coolidge saw that, the challenges to a republic. But also a little known senator named Murray Crane, mm-hmm. after whom the paper company is named. It was the Crane family business, like Crane Stationery. And that company also printed the U.S. dollar in Western Mass. This, he watched Crane operate, and Crane did not yap a lot. He didn't overpromise. He over-delivered with very modest promises, under-promise, over-deliver. And he worked in the background a lot and got a lot done. So he was a U.S. senator from Massachusetts, very different to Henry Cabot Lodge, a kind of a dean of the Senate, and the other senator from Massachusetts. And there's a quiet correspondence between Crane and Coolidge that I think affected Coolidge. Crane, too, was quiet. That doesn't mean he was ineffective. He was very effective. And Crane passed away just around the time Coolidge went onto the stage in Washington. And Coolidge wrote in his autobiography that he regretted so much that he didn't have Crane beside him when it came to making the tough decisions at the Senate as vice president and then as president.
Now, Calvin Coolidge started politically right from the very bottom rung of the minor leagues, if you will. And then he gradually made each step up, which is so important, garnering experience, garnering wisdom, starting at the very bottom on a township committee. And then he arose. How important was that in shaping Calvin Coolidge and his idealism?
Very important. It's said that Coolidge won more elections for different posts than any other U.S. president. And there's an argument for that. In history, you're never right. You're just not wrong. So mm-hmm. far, we're not wrong on that. But Coolidge served on town committees, on the Republican committee. He was a Republican, as clerk of the county, and then later state rep, mayor of Northampton, his town in Western Massachusetts, where Smith College is. In the Senate of the state, then as lieutenant governor, then of course as governor of Massachusetts. That's a lot of posts. He had a law practice. He kept it up to about the gubernatorial period. And he was the kind of lawyer who worked hard for his clients. He wasn't a showy courtroom lawyer. He was more solicitor than barrister, they would say in the UK. That is, he settled a lot, and he always sought sort of the best result. So I think he's a familiar character in the 19th century town and in our towns today. Sometimes you'll have a probate judge whom everyone respects because of his knowledge of the community. Coolidge really knew his community. And at the local level, that was serving the community's needs. If the community needed a sewer system, Coolidge was there to argue for a sewer system, even however unglamorous. It was different to his conception of national government, but we can get to that later.
And Amity, why was it the 1919 police strike in Boston when he was governor? Why and how did that bring him upon the national stage?
Well, first of all, he was a new freshman governor. Second of all, and I know your audience will particularly appreciate this, sir, they were elected every year. It was a one-year term. And you know how hard that would be to run for governor every single year. Mm. But that's the way it was. So he was a freshman governor who was running for office in a divided state where the Republican Party, as today, was splitting up with many progressives in the Republican Party. Oh, well, that's very interesting. Also, there's a wonderful dissertation by John Blair, a University of Chicago dissertation that looks at Coolidge. And what it suggests is Coolidge was very good at getting the immigrant vote. We think of Massachusetts as highbrow. That's kind of silly. Western Mass was an immigrant area. Mm-hmm. I consider immigrants highbrow, but it wasn't. Everyone came over on the Mayflower. Coolidge himself was a swamp Coolidge. That is, he wasn't from the fancy Boston side. And he had these loyal constituents among the brewers, among the Irish Americans. So this Boston police strike was fraught because the Boston policemen were Irish Americans and they had voted for Coolidge, some of them, right? Mm-hmm. But maybe many of them. So he was jeopardizing, insulting a constituency when the police chose to go on strike. What happened was, inflation and strikes go together. It's no accident we have new labor actions now. There was inflation following World War I. The police of Boston were indeed poorly paid. Their salaries were far from keeping up with inflation. They had rats in their station houses chewing on their helmets when they set the helmets down. But their contract said, you can't strike. So they broke their contract and went out on strike, very much like the PATCO union under Ronald Reagan of the air traffic controllers. Good people in a difficult situation opting to push the rules or break them and go on strike. So Coolidge, very tough decision. There was rioting in Boston. There were windows broken. There was looting of all the sneakers in the fine shops, although, of course, it wasn't sneakers or computers or Chanel clothing then, but the equivalent of the looting today. And the merchants were afraid. The merchants lined up for gun licenses. Very familiar scenario. Coolidge supported the police commissioner who reported to him by quirks of mass law. He supported the police commissioner and he fired the policeman. Very tragic situation.
And it was his response to Samuel Gumpers that we remember about what he said, correct? As far as
that is correct. That is correct. Well, he came out with a categoric. There's no right to strike against the public safety by anybody, anywhere, anytime. Mm-hmm. That was rough. He thought he might lose the election. He got bronchitis. He felt terrible for the policeman whom he knew, but he was operating on principle. And there his Amherst network, including some protégés of Garman, who was not exactly a labor fan, they wrote him to support him. And he said in his return correspondence, "I knew you would understand," or "I knew you would appreciate what I did." But a very dramatic thing to do in a state with people not really sure nationally what to do. And the importance of that was sometimes a governor will lead a nation. That is, the nation is confused. It's perplexed on a on an issue. And then one governor's movement will change the whole mood. That's what happened to Coolidge. He did win re-election gubernatorial in 1919 post-strike. And he became a national figure, the fellow who dared to draw the line in the sand. You know, at the time, this was a very well-known story. There was another strike on the West Coast in Seattle, and it was a general strike, which means all industries struck in sympathy with one another. That paralyzes the city. And it was said Seattle was so quiet that the only thing that moved was the tide. Can you imagine? And the mayor there had a nervous breakdown over it. I mean, he fought back, but he quit and said, "I'm going fishing now." Afterwards, it was a very stressful event. I think the factor of inflation is large here. People who go on strike usually have a reason for going on strike. They're not evil. And you know, when we talk about why there's labor action and what we're going to do about it, yes, we should limit the power of organized labor, particularly in the public sector. But we should also ask ourselves, why are these people so unhappy and what can be done to help them?
And Amity, you bring it out in the book, the fact that during the Republican National Convention, 1920, William J. Harding is the nominee, but it was truly a democratic process that brought Calvin Coolidge as being the vice presidential candidate. Truly remarkable. It wasn't done by backroom bosses. This was a democratically elected vice president, correct?
Well, so to speak. I mean, I'm not so opposed to the backroom always. Remember, this is very close to the time we passed the 17th Amendment, when senators before the 17th Amendment were picked by state legislatures. And that sounds corrupt. Oh my God, the cigars, the closed doors. But actually, there's a virtue to that. That was how Murray Crane, whom I mentioned, was picked. When you pick someone from among people you know, you're not so reliant on first impression, whether someone today would be telegenic, because you actually know someone. And we all have people who we like better after knowing them for a while. But anyway, it was a compromise choice, Warren Harding. There were a number of candidates. The party was riven, as I mentioned. Harding got picked in the back room at the Blackstone Hotel. There was kind of a rebellion when it came to the vice presidential candidate. And Wallace McCament of the West stood up on a chair and nominated Coolidge. How did he know to nominate Coolidge? Well, that leadership on strikes, but also Coolidge wrote a beautiful book called Have Faith in Massachusetts about the importance of work of state government. It could be Have Faith in Your State, could be the title. And that book was influential as an example of how a candidate through a work of art, a book, can gain prominence. And we at the Coolidge Foundation recently reprinted this book with a wonderful intro. It's a governor's book. So a wonderful intro by Governor Jim Douglas, who used to be the governor of Vermont, Coolidge's birth state, his home state. And there's all kind of useful thought in that book. McCament, a judge, saw it and said, okay, Calvin Coolidge, who was not a party choice. What else could, I'm just reading a book right now about Henry Cabot Lodge. Henry Cabot Lodge kind of ruled for Massachusetts, and Coolidge was not a Lodge protege. Lodge didn't particularly get the whole thing about Calvin Coolidge. And so that was a bit of in your face to Henry Cabot Lodge, someone from Massachusetts, but not his person.
Truly remarkable. Now, Amity, discuss why, when Calvin Coolidge was sworn in by his father at Plymouth Notch upon hearing the death of William G. Harding. Why was it so appropriate that he would be sworn in such a manner, in such a way?
Well, first of all, it was circumstance. Warren Harding passed away suddenly while the Coolidges were home on vacation at the family home in Plymouth Notch, Vermont, which I hope you come to this summer. Please email me and we'll be glad to host you this summer at the Notch one way or the other. So wow. That it's kind of by, if you know, Killington, the ski resort, Rutland, mm-hmm. Ludlow, you just drive straight up to Albany and then turn right, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Anyway, Coolidge was up there. Word comes by telegram and phone. The president has died. They had to rig wires. It wasn't as if Plymouth was fully electrified at that time. Coolidge came from a very isolated hamlet. Even today, it's isolated. And what do? You don't want to leave the U.S. without a leader. So Coolidge's father, who happened to be a notary public and justice of the peace, did swear him in at the Notch. And that was to prevent there being an interregnum. The U.S. isn't comfortable with that of overnight before Coolidge was sworn in. Then Coolidge went down to Washington. But this scene, and there's some beautiful paintings of it, matters because it is symbolic of Coolidge's notion of the importance of local government. Mm-hmm. Coolidge said, he who holds American citizenship is the peer of kings. And that includes local. He really believed that America grew from the ground up. He didn't like fancy airs. So historical accident and tragedy painted a picture that was perfectly Coolidge. Someone asked Father Coolidge, who was known as Colonel Coolidge, how did you know you had the authority to swear your son in very common law question? And he said, nobody told me I couldn't. Yes. And that's very American in the old way. You can unless you cannot, as opposed to you can't unless you can, which would be more European. So I really like that story. And Coolidge visited his mother's grave before he went to Washington. And there's some beautiful photos, including one you've probably seen, JR, of Coolidge shaking hands with a boy at a train stop, at a whistle stop. From that, he went down and he told people, I think I can swing it. He was well prepared. He'd held just about every job, mm-hmm. except senator.
Yes. So upon becoming president of the United States, Calvin Coolidge establishes two remarkable relationships with two of the people, very, very important people in his cabinet. And please discuss briefly each one, if you could, Amity. One would be Brigadier General Herbert Mayhew Lord and the Budget Bureau. You know, we as constitutional Republicans were always very, very apprehensive about bureaucracy and administration. But this was one bureau that really did the job and really should be restored. But tell us a little bit about General Herbert Mayhew Lord and how important that relationship was with President Coolidge.
Well, I'm going to back up and say the Republican Party platform of 1920, 100 years ago plus, was a very definite platform, and that's kind of what's missing today. So mm-hmm. The platform said, we're going to figure out how to control the budget. The budget was sort of a free-for-all before that. There wasn't a unified budget. And the law that was born of that, which is the Budget and Accounting Act of 1921 under Harding. Thank you, Harding. Hope next week you have the Harding revisionist, JR, mm-hmm. To speak. It created what we would call the OMB, the Office mm-hmm. of Management and Budget. It was an earlier iteration, which gave the president kind of a research office and a tool with which to oversee the budget. And Herbert Mayhew Lord was the second director of this pre-OMB. And he and Coolidge both liked to cut the budget, and they would meet before cabinet meetings and plan cuts so that Coolidge could say no. All the political listeners will know it's very hard to say no to someone who wants a favor from government, especially when you don't know what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. The key to saying no is intense preparation. You really have to know the trade-offs and then you're comfortable. Well, Coolidge did that with Lord, and they met usually on Fridays before the cabinet meeting. I believe in my book, and thank you for mentioning it, it's got a new edition by George Will. writing the intro, and it sold, thank goodness, a 1/4 million copies. I wish it were shorter, but I do recommend it. So this book describes the intense meetings of Herbert Mayhew Lord and Coolidge. Lord was General Lord because he had a military background. Sometimes military people have experience with procurement or with reduction, with austerity. It was a felicitous relationship. And Coolidge did, as I think mentioned before, manage to cut the budget in real and nominal terms as president over 67 months, not just 1 year. The second aspect of that was the growth policy, which came on tax and also goes back to the orientation towards growth in the 1920 platform of the GOP. They said, let's cut the taxes and maybe we won't lose as much revenue as others proclaim if we cut rates. Andrew Mellon, whom Harding tapped for Treasury and Coolidge capped, was key here. And he said, well, you know, in the railroad business, I've noticed when I cut the freight rate, sometimes I get more traffic. We should charge what the traffic will bear, Mellon said, in that kind of 19th century way. And it proved correct. The federal revenues when rates were cut, and they were cut multiple times under Harding and Coolidge, tax rates, the federal revenues did not collapse. They stayed strong enough to sustain surpluses. And Coolidge, you know, really focused on this the way Lincoln focused on prosecuting the Civil War with all his energy, right down to the White House pets. And they had two lions named Budget Bureau and Tax Reduction that were in the menagerie of the Coolidges. They were originally these cubs, a gift from a mayor in South Africa. But anyway, Coolidge named them Budget Bureau and Tax Reduction. And pretty soon, of course, they went off to the zoo. But he'd made his point. I've really got to cut the budget if I'm going to cut the taxes. That's slightly different from today's talk on television.
And during Coolidge's inauguration in 1924, after winning the election, he said, quote, if we wish to erect new structures, we must have a definite knowledge of the old foundations, unquote. Could there be a more conservative philosophy than that?
I don't think so. He was a conservative in that he looked backward for strength. And there's nothing wrong with that. And I don't have it right in front of me, but the best and most articulate version of that philosophy was when he said about the Declaration of Independence, there is a finality that is exceedingly restful. If all men are equal, that is final.
Yes.
And then he said, we can't make any progress from that proposition. We don't need a slew of laws. We need to better serve laws we already wrote. Very interesting. If all men are equal, that is final. If all men are endowed by their creator, that is final. So he was conservative, I'd say, in a productive way, not just an angry way. And he wasn't angry. And he saw room in the Constitution for a lot of views, too. So he was more relaxed about it. And that's interesting because it's not as though there was no progressive pressure in the 20s. There was. As I mentioned, his party was falling apart. So the progressives, Republicans, like those like Theodore Roosevelt or his heirs, could join with the Democrats as they had, you know, Woodrow Wilson had already won an election of New Jersey because of that split. And maybe they could get an absolute majority, progressive Republicans and Democrats, and the GOP conservative would be shut out forever. So Coolidge had to confront that. I see him as a sort of boy with his finger in the dike, a Dutch boy, holding back progressivism in the 20s. He didn't hold it back forever. Then the New Deal came and progressivism, but he held it back for a long enough time that Americans could prosper and see the value in government restraint.
In Amity, he had two crises in his administration, the Mississippi and the Vermont floods. And there was a lot of New England flood, essentially. But there was criticism on why he didn't go and visit these devastated areas. But this is what I've been wanting to ask you. Didn't the influences of T.R., Theodore Roosevelt, and Woodrow Wilson, in essentially expanding the powers of the executive office, taking the office into a totally new direction, didn't that create a false sense in the public's mind of what the presidential responsibility should be? Whereas Coolidge thought more like the founders with federalism and allowing local government to take over. Don't you think that the influences of T.R. and Woodrow Wilson created that environment to where people had these expectations for Coolidge to be visiting these areas of crisis?
Well, surely one philosopher, I think, who influenced Coolidge, though I don't find any evidence of it, so I'm looking for some scholarship to see if there is any, it was Edmund Burke. Mm-hmm. And Edmund Burke said, when you're a national leader, you know, you're a member of MP, member of parliament, a president in the US and so on, you're not the ambassador from your little constituency. You serve all the people. And you see that in American senators all the time saying that I'm not here just to represent my town or my state. I'm here to be a philosopher, particularly in the Senate, and do the right thing for the whole nation. Well, Coolidge, there was a flood in the South, and this terrible flood, the flood of the Mississippi, so beautifully chronicled in books and so tragic, and just hundreds of thousands of acres of wasteland and people lost their homes. I'm thinking of the book Lanterns on the Levee by, let's see, William Alexander Percy, a wonderful book about that. Anyway, Coolidge didn't go because he thought if he went, he'd have to release a lot of federal money to help with the flood. And he thought that was not a great precedent, that the region should take care of itself. He didn't say the tragedy is minor. He led as president the Red Cross, and he sent the Red Cross, but he didn't think the federal government should jump in. And you see that also out of respect for federalism, say George Bush not going to Katrina. The governor is the first authority in a situation like that. He has to invite the president in. Federalism and then kind of divine retribution. People were saying, well, if this flood were in New England, where he came from, he'd care more. Then there was a flood in New England that very year, the Vermont flood, and Coolidge didn't go to that either. Hard-hearted Coolidge didn't care about his home state. It was a wicked flood, 100+, I believe, bridges were destroyed. Many people lost their homes. We have video of that in our Coolidge film, which I hope people watch on Fox, or we'll find a way to show it to your club. Mm-hmm. But anyway, Coolidge didn't go either. And someone who understood him said, from New England, he can't do for his own what he didn't do for others. Mm. Very Coolidge. That was the principle. And this was his way of sort of holding back, trying to restrain legislation which would involve giant federal infrastructure spending. There was infrastructure spending subsequent to these floods, and he did sign off on some of it, but I think he saw himself as limiting the damage by not showcasing the floods. Very traditional, old-fashioned attitude. Mm-hmm.
The similarities between Abraham Lincoln and Calvin Coolidge are truly remarkable, not only in the personal lives of the men, but also in the philosophical ideas and in the religious ideas of the sovereignty of God, predestination, on all those different beliefs in that regard and their upbringing. Isn't it remarkable in your mind? And I would think that Calvin Coolidge probably was the most like Lincoln of any other Republican president we've ever had.
Well, yes, he was. One, they played it up. You know, born in a log cabin, born in a small woodhouse, read law, didn't go to law school. They played it up. The GOP was the GOP, but it was also true. He was like Lincoln. He was more, he was quite considered, as I mentioned, more solicitor than barrister. Didn't like fights too much, but would fight when he had to, and very interested in oratory and good at it in the same way. So I think he's a lot like Lincoln. And one of the few extravagances he permitted himself, I noticed in the presidential spending, was to buy up a Lincoln collection in Washington. Mm-hmm. He loved Lincoln and they were similar. So that's an important connection. I see some of John Adams and I see plenty of George Washington, particularly mm-hmm. in Coolidge's decision not to run again when he could. Mm-hmm. Washington's farewell address and another vanity extravagance Coolidge permitted himself, one of the few, was he allowed a coin to be minted that had both his profile and that of Washington on the side. Ooh, while he was president. So you can see in a man's choice of spending and his choice of decoration what's dear to him. And I think Lincoln and Washington were the big ones.
When I think of Calvin Coolidge, the first word that comes to mind, not only the description as a true constitutional Republican, but also the word restraint. And Calvin Coolidge presents the example for us today that we as Republicans need to look back to and go back to. And I invite the people to get the book Coolidge, read the acknowledgments, read the resources, read the notes, because people truly may not appreciate how hard work it is to put together a book and to do the accurate research. And you have made such an impact on the people in educating them and telling them about Calvin Coolidge. And I just think it's remarkable and worthy of high praise.
Oh, I'm so touched, and I want to thank the Constitutional Republicans for helping to set New Jersey right. And mention as I go out that one of Coolidge's dear friends was Dwight Morrow, who mm-hmm. unfortunately passed away soon after he became senator, but you think of Morrow and Morrow Lindbergh. So thank you for taking the book and Calvin Coolidge this seriously. You're an exception in that, and we are very grateful.
Appreciate your time. Thank you so much. And remember what Lincoln said, liberty to all. Thank you, Amity Schlaes.
Thank you.